Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us here today for our spring 2016 Town Hall. We have lots of updates and information to share, and we decided to change the format by inviting some of you to tell us what's going on in your areas. Just a few housekeeping notes. I'm going to give you a few quick updates. Then I'm going to invite five guests up to talk about some of the work and successes in our organization, talk show style. We'll take just a quick break to pick up your questions, and as always, I'm committed to responding to all of your questions. So please fill your questions while we're talking, so that they're ready to be picked up, because we're only going to take that 5 minutes break before we come back. I want to thank everyone for organizing and attending the Canadian Conference on Developmental Disabilities and Autism. We had one of the largest audiences ever. The committee did a spectacular job planning really meaningful sessions that gave attendees great information and tools to take back to work. And I'm so pleased so many people from St.Amant were able to be there and to benefit from such a well-planned and meaningful professional development opportunity. I want to talk about the engagement survey. I want to thank all of you who took the time to fill it out. Our engagement score year over year went up 6% to 67%, which is 5% above the average for healthcare organizations and 9 points higher than the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority. So we're definitely headed in the right direction. Last year, as a result of the engagement survey, we developed specific training and tools to address what you identified as needs. Last year, just to refresh your memory, you identified that we need to remove barriers to productivity such as work processes and resources, and we need to do a better job of managing performance, providing career opportunities and recognition for staff. So as a result, to address the barriers to work processes, we did the following. We implemented quarterly meetings with each program and corporate services to talk about the processes that were problematic. These meetings have helped identify and solve issues that actually were not difficult to solve, but require communication and teamwork, such as we've ensured that all staff have a St.Amant email address and can receive news and information in that way. We've made many system upgrades to Quadrant, which is our human resource information management system that tracks our data.
And the human resource information systems and staff scheduling groups have shifted how they work with programs for better customer service and consistency within the teams. We've also worked at improving our vacation planning. We've implemented a process around space planning and office moves. We've embraced project management, and every project is now following the same process and has support from the project management office. So as you can see, knowing that we needed to address this area made it a significant priority in our work and how we prioritized initiatives for the year. To improve managing performance and career opportunities, we've streamlined our performance appraisals and implemented career development plans by starting conversations about where people want to see themselves in 5 years, in 10 years, and then how can we support people to achieve their goals. We've implemented and expanded on programs for new Canadians through English at Work and supported people to have their designations recognized in Canada. We're promoting from within when we can. We've developed training to support managers, recognizing that when people are promoted, we need them to support them to be successful. Some of the training that we've introduced includes coaching, conflict resolution, and change management. This year, the themes that emerged from the engagement survey as areas to improve are talent and staffing. And in this survey, talent and staffing is defined as attracting, retaining, and promoting the appropriate people. And also, the other focus was career opportunities. So we're currently developing plans to work on these two areas. To date, the plans include expanding our recruitment and retention efforts and sharing what's working in various areas, finalizing salary reviews to ensure that we're able to offer comparable pay to other similar organizations. We're participating in advocacy efforts like Abilities Manitoba and Disability Matters Vote 2016 to help lobby our funders for increases in overall pay for direct service professionals. We've been working on job descriptions to give clarity to each role within St. Amant. And there are more plans to come, and by all means, if you have suggestions, please speak to your manager. I can't impress upon you enough how valuable it is for you to fill in the actual engagement survey. It's a tool that we use, it's consistent, and it allows us to compare results year over year. Our goal is to have more than 50% of our staff participate, and this year our rate was 33%. So you can see we have a little bit of a way to go. But honestly, it's one of the best tools to have your voice heard as an individual and also as a part of your work unit. Right now, all of this effort and these plans are being made based on feedback from 33% of you. I recognize that the results at 100% filled out the survey could be very different, and our plans and efforts could also be very different. So please, next fall, when the survey comes out, take a few minutes to give us your feedback. We truly do care, and it truly does make a difference. I hope that everyone heard about the Disability Matters Vote 2016 campaign and had an opportunity to participate in some way. I want to show you a quick video that sums up the efforts throughout Manitoba, and then we'll talk about the outcomes of the election and what it means for us. So bring your attention just to the screens for a few moments.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls.
My power's turned on. Starting right.
still got a lot of fire left in me.
The first time I saw that, I actually had goosebumps all over me. I don't know if anybody else had that experience here today, but to be part of such a huge campaign and to see what a difference we made was just awesome. So thank you. Thank you to all of you for helping with the campaign. I was really proud that at every event I attended, there was excellent representation from St. Amant. It's very meaningful in the wider community when we're able to get out and support one another as a whole. I think that's one of the reasons this campaign was successful, because it was cross-disability, so it brought all of our communities together for a shared cause. At the event at the legislature, every time I turned around, I saw somebody here from St. Amant. It was, and I'm sure you had the same experience, so thank you very much. The campaign accomplished a few things. Number one, it raised awareness of disability rights and empowered people within our community to get informed and participate in the election. Number two, it raised the profile of disability issues to the general public and to all of the candidates who ran in the election. And number three, it united the disability communities. This is important because when government is making decisions, they'll remember the sound of 1,600 people in the legislature. They'll remember the questions they got from their constituents when they were door knocking, and that those same people will be there come election time to keep them accountable. They'll remember that they made promises in writing about what they as individuals said they would do, and what their party intends to support to move the rights and services of persons with disabilities forward. So these are all very good things. Moving forward, St. Amant is looking forward to working with our new government and meeting our new ministers to help them to get to know our services. We will walk them through our strategic plan, and we're truly looking forward to gaining a new perspective on how they think we can improve and innovate. I have no doubt that this government wants the same things that we do. And if they don't, we will convince them. St. Amant will also continue to actively work as part of Abilities Manitoba, which will effectively lobby for large changes to the disability sector. When I sat with the Abilities Manitoba folks at their strategic planning session a couple of weeks ago, I think everyone around the table was feeling optimistic and looking forward to forging new relationships. So again, thank you for all of your support. We'll likely be asking for more help as we move forward, because it's important to show a strong, large, and united front when asking for change. Speaking of change, I want to provide you with an update on the Winnipeg Foundation grant. As you're all aware, we received $950,000 in January to support three projects. The first is the living unit renovation. This will be for 3 West, the south part of 3 West. We've been gathering input from staff and families as to what's important to see in a renovation, as well as working with the architect and designers. We plan to start the renovation this fall. We expect it to take a number of months. I actually have a number here, but I'm not going to say it because I want to give us a little bit of flexibility. All of the people currently living on 3 West, the south section, will be relocated in phases until the work is complete. The goal is to renovate eventually all of the living units. We need to do this in sections as we raise the money. The second project is the community clinic. The goal of this project is to improve access to quality medical care by offering specialized services through a mobile and on-site clinic. And most important, it will increase the community's capacity to deliver good medical care to people with developmental disabilities. Through a partnership with the University of Manitoba, medical students will work with our specialists to learn how to deliver appropriate care. That means better doctors and hopefully labs and x-ray offices that are welcoming for the folks that we support. We've already hired one nurse who is supporting the transition of people
from River Road to the community. The last initiative is St.Amant Research Center planning and evaluating three major projects at St.Amant. Currently, there's virtually no data available to help organizations as they embark on these kinds of projects. Specifically around setting up respite services, developing crisis stabilization services, and moving long-term residents from a developmental center to the community. These evaluations will serve to inform other disability service providers on best practice and lessons learned from our experiences. We'll also be using the data collected to adjust our plans based on person-centered outcomes. All of our strategic initiatives are continuing to move forward. Some are entrenched in the projects I've just spoken about. We'll be opening a dedicated respite unit on the third floor north, as well as keeping one dedicated bed on 2 East for children. We expect that to happen after the renovation that I just talked about on 3 West. We have a formal proposal in front of government for the crisis units that will be located in the cottages, and we have a meeting to present to senior management in late June. So that project is well on its way. There is no shortage of people asking when the service will be available. We anticipate renovations taking most of 2017 and hopefully opening in 2018. We've had positive conversations with Children's Hospital and know there is a great need to support children who are medically complex. This supports our role in moving forward towards becoming a healthcare center. We're confident that St.Amant is a much better place for children to be while they wait for permanent community placements. We have staff who are familiar and unfazed by supporting children who have complex health needs in a holistic way so that they can participate in daily activities. We also have the knowledge and experience to support successful community transitions when the time does come. We opened another location on Wall Street as a classroom supported through the autism program. It launched just about a month ago and is centrally located, so it meets the growing program needs and also offers service in another part of the city. The autism programs will be hosting an open house in June, so I encourage everyone that can make it to come out and check the space. Now, as I promised, I am not going to be the only one doing the talking today. I've invited some special guests to join me. These are all people who are working really hard in their respective programs every day, and they are people who embody our values and who have great success stories to share. So without any further ado, I'll move to the talk show format. My first guest is Kristen Madison, who is the Emergency Foster Care Coordinator in Community Services. So, can you all welcome Kristen? Thank you so much for joining me here today, for being the very first person to be interviewed.
Be gentle.
Yeah. And I'm just going to ask random questions here.
Okay.
Emergency foster services are new to St. Amant. Can you tell me a little bit about the service and how it differs from regular foster care?
Yeah, absolutely. So emergency foster services was created... Should I just hold it maybe?
Yeah, try that.
Can you hear me now? Oh, we're not even on. Hello.
Check. Good thing I was the SD. I can't
pay for
time.
Do you want to try and put it back in?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh. This does happen on David Letterman, or used to, right? On David Letterman. On, yeah.
Okay, can everyone hear me now?
Yeah, do you want? Can I start again?
Yeah.
And ask you questions? It's okay.
Sure.
So emergency foster services are new at St. Amant. Can you tell me a little bit about the service and how it differs from regular foster care?
Yes. So emergency foster services was created as part of the emergency placement resource, which is a resource within CFS that allows children that are coming into care to have a placement, whether that's emergency or, I mean, typically it's emergency, so short term. So within our program, we have specialized beds for kids with developmental disabilities as well. So it's a very specialized program within that bigger resource. Within our program, we've also got clinical services supports built in for these kids when they come into our care. And in addition to that, we also will support the parents of those children, because typically it's an apprehension that they come into care for. And so we'll try and help those parents in connecting with the right resources in the community, building on their education to understand how to better care for their child, which allows them to focus on family reunification. So that's kind of one of the differences of, with the emergency foster versus the long-term foster, is that we're short-term, first of all,
yeah,
and that family reunification is a primary focus for us. And so what CFS was finding is that they didn't have a whole lot of resource for kids with disabilities. So that's where we come in too, is trying to educate them a little bit on what.
So there was definitely a need there, but why ask? Why did it make sense for St. Amant to?
Well, I think that St. Amant is a leader in this field, so they recognize that. But I think that much like the Grey Nuns' mission, which was to kind of meet needs where they aren't getting met anywhere else, St. Yeah. Amant has established our, you know, the organization as part of that. And I think that the province came to us to kind of fulfill that role, and rather than saying no, we said, all right, how can we make this work?
Okay. How many spaces are available, and are they all full right now?
Actually, as of this week, we have 6 beds available. Okay. Or sorry, 6 beds. Yeah. One of them is available right now, so we'll see how long it takes to fill that up. It's usually not very long, usually yeah, a couple days. So yeah, and the goal is to have 10 beds eventually.
Good. Okay. Can you tell everybody a little bit about what makes a good foster care provider?
Yes, and we are looking, so spread the word. So a good foster provider is somebody that first and foremost cares about the children that are coming into their home, and has to care about children kind of whatever they're coming with. So they need to be really, really versatile in their skill, they need to be really flexible, and they need to be able to kind of, well not kind of, they need to be able to exercise that care and consistency that all children need, but also be able to provide those firm boundaries while being affectionate and loving when maybe the children aren't acting in a way that would kind of exude that from other people, so we need them to be extra caring and loving.
Right on. So this service started in September. Mm-hmm. Do you have any success stories to share?
Yeah, we've actually had success stories with all of our kids so far, which is really great. But one that jumps out at me is that in April, I was able to support a 8-year-old child that we have in our care to Disney World through the Dreams Take Flight, which is great, but it's extra great for this child because when she came into care, she was in a shelter all by herself because she had such high behavior issues. So the fact that she was able to be on a plane and on a 24-hour trip in Disney World was a huge success for her, and she did awesome. She rode rides with other kids, she met characters, she had candy all day, and it was just, you know, it was a trip of a lifetime. She got to be on global news. It was really cool.
Yeah, it sounds like a perfect day. So that's all the questions I have for you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You did an awesome job.
All right. So.
Pam Dusson, come on up. Pam is a supervisor, for those of you who don't know her, here at River Road Place. And I want to thank you for agreeing to do this today. So River Road Place has seen some organizational changes, and I keep hearing great stories as a result. Can you tell me a little bit about what these changes are?
Well, some of the changes, let's see. We have developmental service instructors that are now called recreational instructors that are now from all the units on their individual units, as well as 3 supervisors that work evenings and weekends to build when the managers aren't here. We take on issues and we help support the staff that are here.
Okay. How is organizing staff differently making a difference in the individuals that live here at River Road?
Well, you get to know the people that you work with, and you personally get involved. There are two RA assistants now on the units that are called RA activity workers, and they help support activities on the unit, as well as the RIs, which are recreational instructors. The activity workers and the RAs all get together and there's more outings. The routines have different, they get choices, and they're able to do much more than they were before.
So as a team, I know this is just kind of a relatively new...
As a team effort, we can support more, plus you're more collaborative.
Okay. Can you share a few real-life stories of how people are benefiting?
We have one of the units now that have breakfast at home, so they don't get food from the kitchen, so they can make their own choices. They can smell the food being cooked. We have different routines that are happening now. They're not all scheduled routines at the same time. They stay up later. They can go on outings. RAs go on outings. They have barbecues outside of St.Amant.
Yeah.
They take them to different places and they don't even come back till 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, I was just reading some of our questions that had come ahead of time, and one of them was, can we leave the hall lights on a little longer in the evening now that people are up later? So that's good. What's your favorite part of your job?
Getting to know everyone personally at a personal level. I like to interact with all the individuals that we support, as well as the staff, and as well as the families. So on a one-to-one basis, you get to know more their likes, their dislikes, and everything about them.
Yeah, and I was saying to Pam when we were we did a rehearsal that I had lunch with her one day, and her and the other two supervisors, and we were just kind of chatting, and I heard the absolute passion for what you do in your work very clearly over a very informal lunch. So, yeah.
Thank you.
What are you excited about for the future of River Road Place?
The three West renovations. We're getting a respite unit. And all the individuals that we support may have private rooms where families can take them. They can have their personal space. Everything can be personalized and individualized per that person, so because everybody is unique. That's it.
Okay, thanks. I was talking to Julie. Did I share this at a town hall? If I did, I'm going to repeat myself. But Julie was telling me about an individual that we support that now has their own room, and her dad comes, I think, almost every day. And, he has a nice, comfortable chair that they can just kind of hang out in their own space. And, if that was a shared room, that's just not necessarily possible. So we're absolutely, I think, focused on, getting to the right place. It's just going to take us a little while to get there. So, Pam, thank you very much. Join me in thanking Pam. Next, I'd like to call on Catherine DeRocher, team leader in the Community Residential Program, to join me here on stage. Everybody here okay out there? Yeah? Good? Okay. Welcome, Catherine.
Thank you.
Okay. So you worked very closely with one of our recent transitions of two women from River Road Place to a community home. Can you walk me through the process, or walk all of us through the process of initially meeting the women to the day they moved out to their home?
Sure. So initially, my primary goal and my focus was just to get to know the women. Get to know their likes, their dislikes, what their routines were like, who was important in their lives, to ensure that we would be able to continue all of those aspects when they did move. So initially what we did is we had a lot of transition meetings where everybody was involved. So the clinicians, the CRP departments, the River Road Place, unit clerks, the unit nurses, everybody that was currently involved in these women's lives. And to ensure that they would have everything they needed to move along, whether that was medical information, specific equipment. And as this was all going on, we were beginning the process of hiring staff for the home that they would live in. And during that process, we ensured that at least one or both of the women were present at these interviews in order to see how they interacted with each other, because that was a very important piece that we wanted to include to ensure that they both felt comfortable with each other. So the ladies were involved in that as well.
Great. Good. Okay, so they've been living in that home for 6 months or more now. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the successes and outcomes they've had since they moved into their own home?
Sure. So one of the biggest things I think initially was that we planned a housewarming party with the women. And that kind of provided an opportunity to bring in anybody that was supporting them in their life here could also come and see their new home and be a part of that if that's what they wanted to do. They invited their friends, their family, like I said, the resident assistants, nurses, clinicians, anybody that was previously involved in their life. And it was fantastic. It was a big party and there was lots of music. One of the women really into a lot of music, and so that was a big part of the gathering.
So how is their life today a little bit different just by virtue of living in that environment versus...
So just by being homeowners now, they're able to be a part of the grocery shopping, the daily cooking, doing their laundry, just the kind of the everyday kind of homeowner's responsibilities. They're a part of every aspect of that. In addition, we've been able to reduce a lot of the restrictive kind of means that were with them. One of the women had very minimal ability to walk at that point when she first moved, and so a big part of her move was us focusing on reducing the restrictions that she had in her chair. She wasn't able to communicate as much with us, and so what we did is we really focused on encouraging, with the help of physiotherapists, helping her walk, and that provided her with a lot more control over her environment. She was able to go from room to room, choose the type of music she wanted. We had switch-operated radios that she could turn on and off. She could go into any room that she wanted to go within her home. We had a room that was specifically full of sensory items, so there was a bubble tube, there was a vibrating chair, there was switch-operated radios, specialty lighting, just a place where she could go in and feel calm and relaxed if she wanted to go there.
What about family involvement? Are families over there at all? Is there?
Yes, both of the women have their family come regularly. They come and they'll cook meals. They've also, one of the women recently had a birthday party and she had her extended family, cousins and friends of the family. They all came and just filled the home, and she was able to be a part of that and be the host for her own birthday party. And she chose the music she wanted. So it's really exciting.
So what's the best part from your perspective in supporting people to transition to the community living?
So the best part for me is just seeing the women flourish in a home that was specifically engineered, built for them, and for them to have the supports that they need to be part of their own community and whatever way that they want to be a part of that.
Right on. Okay, Catherine, that's all I have for you. Thank you very much. And now, I'd like to welcome Bobby Lynn Pinkerton. Bobby Lynn is a participant in the Leisure Guide and also a regular at the FM Cafe. Isn't that right, Bobby Lynn?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, you love the, yeah, and then we're going to talk a little bit about that. So. I'll let you get comfortable there. You okay?
Yep.
All good? Yeah. I can hear you and everybody can hear you out there too, so that's good. So can you tell me a little bit about your experience at the FM Cafe?
When I first started guitar lessons, I felt like full of myself.
Yeah. You when you started playing the guitar, you felt really good?
Yes, I did.
Okay, and so people understand, because not everybody's been at the FM Cafe.
Right.
What do you do at the FM Cafe when you...
After I perform, I help out.
So you perform, that's one thing that people don't know, that you have a chance to come and perform on your guitar, and do you have a few songs you do, or?
Yep.
You do, yeah.
And I just want to point one thing out.
Sure.
If it weren't for this job, I would not afford a cell phone.
Okay. Now, for the job, Do you want to talk a little bit about your job?
Sure.
Because I told Bobby Lynn that she had everybody's attention, and she has a business that she'd like to tell you about. So what do you, you should be doing my job.
I got something for you.
You got, oh.
My first business card.
So. Can I look this up for everyone?
Pardon?
It says Pinky's Lawn Care. And it has your phone number and home number on it. Your mobile number and your home phone number.
Yes.
Now, I'm not going to say those out loud right now, but I'll tell everyone that this card, and well, you're going to be here for a while, and I'm going to put this card right on the desk here. So if anybody wants to come and talk to you about you doing lawn care, that'd be awesome.
Sure.
Can I switch topics now?
I have one more thing
okay.
to show you.
That's good.
There's my cell phone.
That's a very so this is the cell phone
yeah.
that you were able to purchase because you have the job.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Ever since St.Amant hired me to do lawn care, if it weren't for St.Amant, I wouldn't reach this goal.
And a few people that work for St.Amant too, I think.
Yeah.
And I just like to say that my 15-year-old has one of these, and he does not work for it. So I think I would like you to talk to him. Would you be willing to have a little chat with my son?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
To make me live on my own. Thank you very much.
Wow, that's awesome. Very nice. So you also participate in the Leisure Guide, right?
Yes, I do.
What activity are you involved in with Leisure Guide, or have you done more than one? I don't know.
No, I actually have a real job now at St.Amant.
Right.
So St.Amant that I got another new lawn.
Oh, good. But just, I was asking more about, you know, when you're not working,
uh-huh. right,
and you're at the FM Cafe, or you go sometimes to the Leisure Guide, what kinds of things do you do there? That
I do soccer.
Oh, soccer. That's good.
Yep.
That's a very active one.
It is.
So did you know how to play soccer or play soccer before?
Yeah.
And now you're just going to get out there and have a little bit of fun?
Yep.
We should all be outside playing soccer right now. It's a beautiful day. Okay, have you participated? What other things do you do in the community, Bob?
Let me think about this.
Do you have any favorite restaurants or places you like to go?
I do. I have a few of them.
What's any recommendations for everybody here as to where you would go to eat?
Sure.
Where?
I would recommend the Fort. They have such good fish and chips.
Hey, that's actually a bit of a hidden secret. That's a very good one. Okay, so I think that's all the questions that I have for you, and I really want to thank you, and everybody here wants to thank you for agreeing to come and do this today.
You're welcome.
Yeah, that was awesome. Last, but certainly not least, I'd like to welcome Marielle Gagnier. Marielle. Is an instructional assistant at St.Amant School. So can you tell everybody here a little bit about St.Amant School and how kids come to be at the school?
Sure. St.Amant School specializes in working with individuals with behaviors as well as complex medical needs. We often get calls. Am I too close?
You're okay.
We often get calls from different schools to assist them in how to deal with behaviors, as well as for assistance to develop programs so that they can teach their students. As far as how a student is selected to become a student at St. Amant School, I'm not sure as I'm not part of that process.
Okay.
And our goals for our students are to first work on the behaviors and also to get them back into their home schools.
Okay. What makes St. Amant School a great place for students who need that extra support?
We have a lot of special qualities in the school. I would have to say number one is the staff. We have a lot of talented staff that work in the school, and we're also very lucky to have a high staff to student ratio. Another is our knowledge and our experience working with this population. The interdisciplinary team that we have here on site, which consists of teachers, instructional assistants, nurses, we have people from the psychology department, we have physiotherapists, OT, and probably a whole bunch more that I haven't mentioned.
You did pretty good at naming just about all.
We want to give the students good experience. We want to see them succeed. Our diversity as a staff, we have a lot of staff from different backgrounds, different cultures, and we all bring our own perspective, and that's what makes us an awesome team. One more is the laugh, the fun that we have, being able to laugh at ourselves. Even when things don't work out the way it's supposed to. We want to see our student develop to their full potential, be the best person they can be.
That's awesome. Can you, some of us are familiar that you worked a lot with one particular student recently. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. I was really privileged and lucky, fortunate to work with a little 8-year-old boy that is autistic. He was having a lot of, he had difficulties being in a regular classroom setting before he came to St. Amant. He had, or he has, a big heart, beautiful smile, a great laugh. He was also a little mischievous at times. An example of that is he loved the couches that were situated in the back of the cafeteria, and he would run and go to them and he would start jumping. And of course I would go and get him and I would give him a look and where I'd just say his name, and he would start laughing because he knew he wasn't supposed to take off on me. So he just started laughing. So that was fun. Another need is his home school was having difficulty meeting his needs.
Right.
And his behavior, they were having a tough time with that as well.
Okay. Can you tell me about the work that was done to actually return him to that home school?
Sure. The first year that this individual was here, we went to his home school for 1 hour every couple of weeks or so. The second year, we increased it to an hour and a half every week. And during that time, we joined the classroom and we would do some of this school work from here. We would take to his other school and do, and then once that was done, he would join the rest of his classmates and do whatever the activity that they were doing on their lessons. And during that time, it was, the day that we went, it was, they did reading. So this individual would join a small group of other students, and they would sometimes read to him on a one-to-one basis, or read as a group and play educational board games. The second part of the afternoon would consist of doing art projects. So he would do the same art project that his classmates were doing. So it made him feel like part of the class.
Yeah.
And the students got used to this individual, the way he communicated. And every so often we had to leave the classroom because he needed to get some of his energy out. So we went for walks and the other students kind of got used to that as well.
Right on. So where he's at his home school now, and do you ever see him?
He does come once a week for our pool program and the music program.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's nice to see him.
So I'm not sure I need to ask this question because I think you've already answered it about in 8 different ways, but how does it make you feel to have supported him?
I sometimes I get emotional thinking about this individual, but I'm extremely happy for this individual, for all his successes, all the great work that he's done to be where he is today. Yeah, it's like night and day. He's grown up so much. He's made new friends at his school. Every once in a while I'll get pictures, and I just see him glowing and him being so happy.
Do you know what amazes me when I ask you that question?
No, what?
I asked you I was expecting how you were gonna feel, but all you talked about was how he feels and how he's doing. That's awesome. Yeah.
I never even heard it.
So, thank you very much. Thanks, everyone. That concludes. You did an awesome job for all of you. Wow. We'll do that again. So thank you to Mary Al, and thank you to all of the guests for sharing a piece of their work. I know that all of you have stories like this, success stories and stories that touch your heart. I want to say I'm very, very proud to be here at St. Amant and of all of the work that we've accomplished. I'm so very grateful, and I underline this, to work with all of you, people who are clearly very committed and passionate about the individuals you support. Well, now we're just going to take a 5-minute break, collect questions, and then we'll be back. Okay? Thanks.